share my screen. Okay. All right. So just a quick recap. We started the course day before yesterday, Wednesday, and we talked about the characteristic function as a Fourier transform of PDFs. We talked about some common tricks, some common transformations to get hold of martingales and log of martingales, and to get their characteristic functions in particular. And then we have started talking about some common probability distributions and their characteristic functions. So we already discussed exponential and gamma, and also Levy processes, where it gets a little bit more complicated, that we have already mentioned. So today, let us go back to the most popular distribution of all, the normal distribution. But before I start, are there any questions from last day's class?
Sir, for the Levy process, is there any reference for the derivation of characteristic function that is given?
For Levy process, the best reference is Kont and Tankov. Rama Kont and Peter Tankov. Okay, it tells you everything that you need to know about Levy processes and how they are applied in finance. But of course, all the standard probability stochastic process books has some treatment of the Levy process, but it may be a bit more on the theoretical side. So at least for this course, I am not interested in the pure theory. My focus would be on how it is applied in financial situations. For that, I think Rama Kont and Peter Tankov is the best.
Okay, sir.
All right. So let us begin with the standard normal distribution, the most important distribution in statistics, in probability, like everywhere. So it is the main component of a diffusion process. So we have already discussed the diffusion process last term, which is our main toolbox for the financial asset pricing models. So normal distribution is the main component of that diffusion process. And so obviously it is absolutely central to everything that we discussed. Most of the models that we use, more than 90% would rely on the normal distribution. The typical notation is we call Z following normal 0, 1, and the characteristic function of Z, which is phi Z nu, or expectation of e to the power I nu Z is, this is the definition, integral over the density I nu Z minus half Z squared dZ. Instead of directly looking at the characteristic function, let us look at this alternative integral, the moment generating integral, because that will be easier to start the discussion with. If we look at this particular expectation, e to the power s z, so instead of I nu, I have s, so it becomes a real argument here. I can complete the square. So this is just the usual trick. I try to complete a square so that I have two separate terms here. And this is a result that we have been using for a long time now for normal distributions, that this particular integral e to the power minus half u squared du is root over of 2 pi. It is not a straightforward result, but we have been using it for quite some time now. So we use this result in this context to get the expression of expectation of e to the power sz, which would come out to be expectation of a square by 2, because this integral by root over of 2 pi would be exactly 1. So that's why we use this, this particular expression here to get a hold of a simpler expression. And then we argue that we can substitute I nu for s and use the analytic continuation of functions to claim that the same formula is also true for a complex argument. So if I substitute S by I nu, just mechanically, I will get the expression e to the power minus nu square by 2. And why is this valid? That requires a bit of argument, just like Arindam, you have a question?
No, sir.
Oh, okay, because on Wednesday also we had this question that can we insert complex arguments inside the characteristic function definition? So it requires the same kind of care here also. And I do need a little bit of arguing regarding the analytic continuation of functions to establish that indeed this is the valid thing to do. So once I know that this is valid, then the formula, deriving the formula is extremely simple. I just replace S by I nu, so I will get e to the power half minus half nu square. So that happens to be the characteristic function of a standard normal distribution. So is this clear? So we are using a couple of tricks, but these tricks are more or less standard in probability textbooks. One is this result, this integral being root over of 2 pi, that we have used, even I think all of you have used before for normal distribution. And the other trick is, once I get hold of this expression for a real argument, I can use some analytic continuity to establish this result also for a complex argument. So is this flow clear?
Yes, sir.
Because I'm using certain things without explicitly justifying. So this one is a formula which I think all of you know how to do. It takes quite a bit of tedious algebra, but I think you know this, right? Do you know how to derive this integral, or have you been only using it?
We know how to derive.
You know how to do it, correct?
Yeah.
Yes, yes. Great. So that part is done. The other part is this part, which I think you don't know yet. Are you having a complex analysis course? I don't know. I don't recall the exact syllabus now. In our MSTAT program, is there a complex analysis course in the first year anymore? Or
yes, there is one course, but
yes, but not all of us. Not, yes,
it's not compulsory. Of course, it is elective. Yes, no. Even in our time, it wasn't compulsory. It was an elective course. But so some of you have taken that course, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so then you have seen this analytic continuation arguments?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah. So if the, you know, if some understanding is lacking, then we can do the explanation. But for now, it suffices to say that it is actually valid. We can do that. And we can finally arrive at the characteristic function for the standard normal distribution. All right. So for now, let us take it at face value, but you can all verify this looking at any standard textbook of complex analysis. So if we understand the standard normal distribution, then we can also understand any normal distribution. We know that we can just make a simple transformation. If Z is normal 0, 1, then I can always define a new random variable AX with mean mu and standard deviation sigma by this simple transformation. So X is mu plus sigma Z for studying any normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square. This we have been again been doing from our first year undergraduate. So the characteristic function will be a direct corollary, direct extension of the standard normal characteristic function. So for X, I call it phi X, which is e to the power I nu x. And I can, of course, write x as mu plus sigma z. I can take mu outside. And nu sigma I can write it as one single argument here. So I know that this should give me e to the power minus half sigma nu whole square. So collecting terms, this is my final expression for the characteristic function of any normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square, which is phi x is e to the power I mu nu minus half sigma square nu square. And if you recall at least one version of central limit theorem that uses this characteristic function argument to establish the theorem. So it looks at a infinite expansion and then truncates terms and argues that the terms which are ignored are actually small enough, so that we can show that arithmetic mean, scaled arithmetic means go to normal distribution. Yes? Okay. So I assume it's a random noise, so I will carry on. And just to recall, we have discussed the Brownian motion last term. Brownian motion is again a very important component for all our models, most of our models. And we will be, without any more discussion, we'll be using the fact that the difference in Brownian motions, Wt minus W0, and it will be Wt if I standardize W0 at zero. Is there an audio problem? I get some noises, little bit of noises. Okay, fine. So the difference in the two time points that follows a normal distribution with mean zero and variance t. So variance is proportional to the elapsed time. So we have discussed this very carefully last term, and we have looked at the pitfalls of trying to define a derivative, a symbol like dw dt, and where we run into trouble. So that discussion is already there. Just try recalling it, because once the semester exam is over, I am assuming that you have almost perfect memoryless property, so you may not remember most of it. So therefore, if I define my xt as wt, so this x here, so I'm keep using this symbol x. So if I use my xt as wt, then its characteristic function will also be given by the normal distribution characteristic function. The variance will be of the order t, so expectation of e to the power I nu xt can be written as e to the power minus half nu square t. So instead of sigma square, I will have t here. So a characteristic function for the changes in the Brownian motion can also be written in terms of this same standard normal distribution. All right, this is clear?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So basically, what we are looking at now is the standard normal distribution and its characteristic function, and then using it to visualize any normal distribution with any mean mu and variance sigma square, as well as the important case of the Brownian motion, where the variance is proportional to t. So these expressions we'll be using again and again, obviously, because this will be our ingredient for most of the models. So let us now start talking about the models. Some of these models have already been discussed last term, but as in the book, I'm going to do a review, and then basically from the review, we will start digressing to more generalized models. We will start with the simplest model, which is the geometric Brownian motion that gives rise to the Black-Scholes differential equation. We have done that before, but now we will slowly generalize certain features and see where it leads us in terms of a more general model or a more comprehensive model. And of course, we will run into trouble some of the time. We will not be able to derive analytical expressions, etc., etc., all the issues that we discussed on Wednesday. But it's good to go with the flow, that to start with the simplest model because we already know about it, we are familiar with that model, and then start generalizing in different directions. So our stochastic models of asset prices will start with the geometric Brownian motion, which has the differential, the stochastic differential equation dst equal to r minus q st dt plus sigma st dw. In fact, when we define the canonical model, we did not always use r minus q. We sometimes started out with mu st dt, and then we showed that under a risk neutral world, I can equate mu with r. I can forget mu, replace it by r. And if there are dividends, I can simply look at r minus q, if q is the dividend rate. So Hirsa uses this whole thing together and defines the generic SDE as r minus q st dt sigma st dwt. In fact, it might look more familiar if you divide both sides by st, because then you will get the more standard, simpler version. But anyway, we all know this, so I don't need to repeat this point anymore. And we also know that if I use the Itô's lemma, the cornerstone result that we discussed last term, then the distribution of S capital T, so the distribution of the stock price at terminal time capital T, or in fact, what we are interested in is the log of that stock price, log capital ST. We use the notation small st to, as usual, small st is log of capital ST. The distribution of that will also be normal. The mean will be given by S naught, which is the time zero value of the log of time zero value of the stock, plus R minus Q minus half sigma square into capital T. So this will be the mean of the distribution. And of course, sigma square T will be the variance. So variance will be again proportional to time. So is this okay? Because I'm just repeating last term's result, so I'm not going to explain this anymore.
Yes.
Yeah. So because this is, again, I'm doing a recap. So this was our canonical structure, and we also had the Black-Scholes PDE, which we know how to derive, and then solving it, we get the, all the European auction prices, et cetera, et cetera. So the Black-Scholes PDE is now del V del T, where V is the contract. So del V del T plus half sigma square square del 2 V del S square, R minus QS del V del S. So again, instead of simply R, Hirsa keeps using R minus Q, as I mentioned. So we have to remember that actually there was a dividend that is equal to RVST. So this is by the risk, instantaneous risk-free portfolio construction argument. So this is how we set up the PDE. We eliminate the stochastic part, it becomes a PDE, and then it can be solved given the boundary conditions. So that was what we knew already. And now we can just add the characteristic function of the log of this geometric Brownian motion, because this is something that we are studying seriously now. The characteristic function again will be derived from the normal distribution, and the form will be obviously given by I mean into nu minus half sigma square nu square into t. So the mean is coming from here. So it's S naught R minus Q minus half sigma square into time t. So that will be our mean parameter inserted. And because sigma square capital T is the variance, so I'll have half sigma square nu square capital T. So these are the ingredients in our geometric Brownian motion model. I have the stochastic differential equation here. Then I have the Black-Scholes PDE. And in addition, I now also know the form of the characteristic function for this process. So this is basically what we have been using a lot last term. We know this model reasonably well. But now it is time to, as I said, relax certain assumptions, generalize this model in various directions. So the first discussion that I want to bring up here is that volatility in financial asset prices is generally not constant over time. So financial asset prices are generally not homostatic. I don't know whether you have started the financial econometrics lectures yet. Did you have any classes yesterday?
Yes, we had one introductory class.
You had an introductory class. So did you see any graphs?
No.
Because usually, you know, all the financial econometrics textbook starts with some time series plots of returns to highlight the feature that volatility is not uniform over time. Anyway, so we will see a lot of graphs here. So what happens in financial data is that volatility itself is influenced by market information. When new information comes in, different types of information comes in, the market reacts, of course. The market will, of course, react in terms of the return. The return may go up and go down, but also it is the rate of fluctuation that can depend on the information content. So not only there is an up and downward movement, but also the extent of the movement can depend on time. So that's why I said that financial asset returns are generally never believed to be homostatic. Even though our canonical Black-Scholes model that we rely on actually uses a constant sigma. So constant sigma, of course, means I assume that the model is homostatic. So that is the first line of departure from our Black-Scholes PDE setup, from our typical GVM setup. So the first attempt in this direction attributed to Darman and Kani is called the local volatility models. So local volatility models relaxes the constant volatility assumption so that volatility can become a function of asset price. Of course, it's a function of asset price because we actually are looking at log asset price here. So your volatility is really proportional to the stock price if you see, look at this carefully. But Darman and Kani model allows the volatility to be also be a function of time, directly, explicitly to be a function of time. So what happens here is now the SDE becomes, it looks similar, but now I allow time dependence in the returns, in the dividend, as well as in the volatility. So all the simple tricks that we used to create our riskless portfolio, etc., has to be done much more carefully, generalized, because now all our parameters become explicitly time dependent. So I have RT, I have QT, and I have sigma explicitly depending on ST, T, apart from the fact that ST is also here. Because having ST here is easy. If I just divide throughout by ST, then I can get rid of this ST term on the right-hand side. But if I insert ST explicitly inside the argument of sigma, then I no longer have that freedom. Whatever I do, my volatility is still explicitly dependent on stock price as well as time. So it is important to understand these nuances because in empirical work, this creates a lot of difference. You understand that the earlier version, we had some constant parameters. So estimating this model was terribly easy. And you also have an analytically closed form expression. So you can plug in good estimates and get a very good calibration of the model. So everything is very happily done. As soon as you make your parameters time dependent, the dimension of the parameter space changes totally. Now you are estimating a function. And if you want to make it a completely free function, obviously you will run out of degrees of freedom in a time series context. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Is this point clear? that if I have a time dependent parameter, then immediately I run into degrees of freedom trouble. So naturally, we will never be able to solve this problem without any other constraints. We have to constrain it somehow so that we have some degrees of freedom to work with. In fact, if you look at the corresponding generalized Black-Scholes equation, that Black-Scholes equation itself will now have all time dependent parameters. So even as a PDE, this will be terribly hard to solve. This will be an impossibly hard PDE to solve, where all the parameters are time dependent. You will need a lot of assumptions on the functional forms of R, Q, and sigma to begin the process of a solution. So that's why the Darman-Kenny model, even though it is theoretically very nice, very correct, it is not very useful in practice. So if you really want to work with data, because after all, we need numbers, we need to work with data, a general model like this, a fully general model, is not useful. Okay. In fact, in general, there is no analytical form available for the characteristic function itself. So you can't even derive the characteristic function like you did here in this case, in the geometric Brownian motion case in 119. You don't have a similar nice closed form expression for the characteristic function because of this time dependence issue in general. So what we really need to do is somehow simplify the model. I need to retain heteroscedasticity. I know that homoscedasticity is a bad assumption. So I need to allow for heteroscedasticity, volatility to change, but I need a simpler change model. I need to propose a change model which is simpler, which is less parameter heavy, so it becomes analytically tractable again, at least empirically tractable, if not analytically tractable. So in that direction, a very, very popular model is the Heston's model. So Heston's model is geometric Brownian motion with stochastic volatility. It's a very specific kind of heteroscedasticity. And once, so have you studied the Gartz model in time series?
No, sir.
No. I am sure that Gartz model will be part of the financial econometrics course. So, any of you know the definition of the Gartz process?
No, sir.
Okay. So, I don't want to spend time on that right now because then I'll be basically repeating something that will be covered anyway in much more detail in the financial econometrics course. But I will just say that Gartz is an ARMA process. ARMA process, all of you know from time series, but Gartz is an ARMA process in the residual square. The usual ARMA process is in the mean, where the time series value itself is modeled as a function of lagged time series values and lagged errors. Instead of that, if you take the residuals of the model and try to model the square of that residual with an ARMA structure, that is a Gartz model. So maybe now that we are doing online, so I should make use of my degree of freedom. And just show you the equation and maybe this is the wrong page. Just a second. Right. Usually Wikipedia has nice visuals also. Okay. So can all of you see the screen here?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So this is the arch model. So without the G. So what I was talking about had a G, but now for the time being, forget the G. Then you have arch model. So first let us look at the arch model. Arch model is where the volatility sigma square is modeled in terms of lagged residual squares. So it is like a moving average type process. So it's a moving average of past error squares, past square residuals. That is arch. So it is like an MA. And in addition, if you also put lagged values of past, lagged values of squared sigma, so you not only have squared residual from the past, you also have squared sigma from the past, then it becomes a Garch model. So Garch model is truly like an ARMA process. So sigma square T is modeled by past values of sigma square, that is the AR part. In addition, the past values of the residuals plays a role like in a MA part. So it's ARMA in squared residuals. That's the Garch process. Okay, can you see the similarity? You all have done ARMA process last term, so you should be able to identify the structure.
Yes, sir.
And I was hoping that there would be some graphs. There are no graphs here. So maybe I will just... Yeah, this is a good example. How do I make it full screen? I want to make this plot full screen. How can I do that?
Right click and open image in new tab possible.
Open link in new
open tab. Image in new tab.
Open image in new tab. Thank you. Great. So this is a canonical example of graphs that teachers usually show and in the financial econometrics course to motivate the Garch model or motivate heteroscedasticity in returns. So if you look at this plot, you will see that these are returns. Actually, these are residuals from returns, of course, but there are not much of a change in the expected value of the residuals. The expectation is more or less flat. There might be slight changes, but if you try to estimate the mean, it would still be sort of constant zero. So that is not the issue we are worried about. But what we do see in a very prominent manner is that the fluctuations around this mean changes a lot. Sometimes it is very sedate, very little fluctuations, and sometimes there are zones, intervals of very high fluctuation. So fluctuations tend to be clustered. So that's why in finance we call it volatility clustering. So this is volatility clustering, and that is where the Garch type of models comes into play. Because you see, if you look at this carefully, if you want to model this kind of fluctuation where there is cluster, then the first thing that you should try to do is try to establish an autocorrelation between current residual square with the past residual square. Because large fluctuation tends to be followed by a large fluctuation, and small fluctuations tend to be followed by a small fluctuation. If you look at this graph, you will see that pattern. Because there are some consecutive small fluctuations, then there are consecutive large fluctuations. So it is like an autoregression, it is like an autocorrelation. But that autocorrelation is not in the residual, but in the residual square. So that's where this Garch modeling idea comes from. So is the pattern clear? Can you all understand what I am talking about? Because these are the kinds of data that you will see when you start working with data.
Yes, sir.
So primarily our attention will be almost always on this volatility clustering and how to model it smartly in the sense of without losing too much degrees of freedom, so that we can calibrate our models and get good results. In data work, GARTS model is the most popular model for this purpose, as we already mentioned. And if you think of the diffusion process, which is nothing but a continuous time version of the corresponding time series model, the geometric Brownian motion model that we have been studying, if I want to introduce GARTS-like feature, then the stochastic volatility model happens to be the most popular. This was proposed by Heston, and of course, this has been used and generalized a lot over the years. And when we were students, these were very new. So now I can no longer say that these are very new, but all I can say is this has now become like bread and butter for all financial econometricians. These models are automatically taken on board, and then you look for the right adjustments to the model in your own particular case. So Heston's model is actually a continuous time version of the GARTS model, which you will study later. The SDE, so because for our model, for our modeling exercise, it is always the SDE that's our building block. So for the Heston stochastic volatility model, we assume that ST follows this particular stochastic process model, this particular system of SDEs. So what does it say? So let us spend a little bit of time admiring this. So DST is RST DT. So now again, R is constant. So you see, the smartness in modeling is always in trying to generalize one direction at a time. So Darman and Kani, if you look at it, there were multiple directions where generalizations happened. So you made the returns time dependent, you made the volatility time dependent, you also made the volatility stock price dependent. So there were three dimensions where generalization happened. And if you want to handle all of them together, it becomes terribly difficult. And that's why Darman Kani is not very useful. So what Heston is doing in the initial model is that, let us keep R constant. So let's take without loss of generality, Q equal to zero, R is a constant. So the first term, the trend term, is exactly as before, as in the geometric Brownian motion model. Nothing changed. The change is only in the volatility part here, and that is done in a very clever manner. What do? You have STDWT. This part is again as before. Here in our original model, we had sigma. In the canonical model, we had a constant sigma. In the Darman-Kani proposal, we had sigma as a function of ST and T. But that was too much. So to begin with, let us just take sigma T. And how do I model sigma T? That's the trick. The trick is, take the square root of another process Vt, square root of a new process Vt. So Vt is as if the underlying volatility generating process. Vt is generating the volatility. And what is the driving equation for this volatility? So dVt, the change in this driver, is given by kappa times theta minus Vt dt plus sigma square root of Vt dw. So now let us look at this very carefully. This is extremely critical. This term should remind you of something that we discussed last time. What is the model that it reminds me of? Anyone? We have discussed this model last time.
BNS.
Mean reverting.
This is mean reverting. Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process.
Right.
We will study Ornstein-Uhlenbeck again in more detail, but this is the mean reversion process. So what does it do? Theta is like the mean anchor for the volatility. Theta is like the mean value of sigma square. So if I am away from theta, this mean reverting term will bring me back at speed kappa. So kappa is the speed of mean reversion. So that's the trend part for the volatility. So volatility tends to stick around theta. If I am very far away, it will take me some time to come back. So that's how I will get volatility clustering. So once there is a big value that has been realized, subsequent values will tend to be bigger, but then slowly they will adjust to the long-term mean. And again, when it becomes too small, they will be brought back up to the level of theta gradually. And the speed of adjustment is kappa. And of course, it has to be a stochastic process. So there is a volatility of volatility here. And that is driven by a sigma, constant parameter sigma, and square root of its own value. Why is the square root important? So, of course, the expression, the explanation is written here, but you should be able to identify this intuitively, immediately. What is the role of this square root Vt appearing in the generating function of Vt? What is it actually doing?
Making Vt positive.
Yes. So the most important role of this term is actually keeping the volatility from becoming negative. Because of course, it's a volatility model. So we need to make sure that it do not slip below the zero line. That becomes very important. Okay, so if ever it becomes very small, then with a little bit of fluctuation, it can slip below zero. So what this model will do is, if it gets close to zero, then the fluctuation itself is made very small. So the second term here can contribute very little. And in fact, it cannot go below zero. And of course, the first term will always try to bring it back up. So suppose theta is a positive number, of course, theta is, you know, quite above zero. If the volatility slips below theta, close to zero, then there is a chance that dWt2 might have a large negative value and it will slip below zero, which should not be allowed to happen because it's volatility. So I multiply it with the square root Vt. So the contribution of this term becomes less and less important. It cannot go below zero. So basically zero works as a reflecting barrier. And meanwhile, the trend term theta minus Vt dt, this term will try to bring it back up to theta level. Is this clear?
So can this be proved that this Vt process always remains above zero?
Yes, it can be proved. In fact, the proof is not difficult. You just check the probability of this being less than zero.
I mean, it should depend on what the kappa and theta values are. I mean, is it true that for any kappa and theta this is positive? I mean,
for any strictly positive theta, it is true.
Okay.
So it will not depend on the magnitude of kappa theta. As long as theta is away from zero, it is true. So Of course, because there are two driving equations, one for the actual stock price and the other for the volatility process, I need two Brownian motion components. So they are called W1 and W2. And in these models, usually we also allow for a possible correlation between the Brownian motion components, because it is quite likely that the same news, the same information drives both the trend as well as the volatility. Maybe in different ways, maybe in different extent, but it is quite likely that some news items will drive both of them. So the changes in the stock return and the volatility should have some correlation, at least have some scope for correlation, which can be estimated from the model. So in general, the statement of this model allows for a correlation of rho, rate rho. I say rate because it's on DW, that's why it's a rate. Nu t is our mean reverting stochastic volatility. This we have already explained. Theta is the long-term variance, kappa is the speed, sigma is volatility of the variance. And this term is essentially preventing volatility to become negative. So it will force the diffusion component to zero as volatility approaches zero. So Heston's model is a very, very nice model for many reasons. The first reason is, of course, it somehow summarizes all the important features of stochastic volatility in these two equations. If whatever story you can think of looking at this particular picture, because this is our driving point. This kind of picture is our driving point. I want to model this in continuous time. I know in discrete time, I have the Gartsch model. In continuous time, things are usually harder. So this is my driving feature. Heston has been so popular because it has been very successful in encapsulating all the features of that volatility clustering picture into these two equations. And the second reason is, for doing so, Heston does not use too many degrees of freedom. Of course, there are some additional parameters, but not that many. I have this kappa, theta, these things are coming as extras, but it is not too much. I have to estimate three new parameters, kappa, theta, and rho. But with just additional three parameters, I can capture a lot of important features in financial asset returns. And that is where the popularity and beauty of Heston's model lie. Okay, so we will take a break now. It is 11:22 on my computer. So we will restart in 15 minutes. All right. So let us pick up from where we stopped. We were talking about the Heston volatility model, and I talked about the features of this model. So are there any questions at this point? Any clarification that you would like to have?
Oh, can you explain the DVD part of the Heston stochastic volatility model again?
See, DVD is the part that drives the change in volatility. You see, if you look at the first equation, STDW is just as in the geometric Brownian motion. Here, I had a constant sigma in the geometric Brownian motion. Instead, in the Heston's model, we insert square root of Vt. Now, what is the role of this square root of Vt? This is now acting as the source of sigma. So Vt is like sigma square. And the driving equation for this Vt, so you can think of this intuitively as d sigma square, d sigma t square rather, that has a mean reversion process in the trend. So long-term variance is pegged at theta. So whenever there are deviations, this process will try to bring the volatility back to the level theta. That's one part. The other part is there is a pure stochastic change in the volatility. stochastic fluctuations to the volatility, and that is moderated by this square root of Vt term again. Why this moderation is needed? Because I do not want volatility to slip below zero. Volatility should not be negative. So if it gets too close to zero, then these fluctuations will become smaller and smaller, and one can show that then it will stop from slipping below zero. And of course, the long-term trend then will bring it back up to the level theta, close to the level theta. So that's the role of this Vt. So this Vt encapsulates volatility clustering in the sense that volatility will be driven by past values. So big volatility fluctuations will be followed also by big fluctuations. But in general, there will be a tendency to come back to a long-term average value. And the last part is the check part, where it prevents it from going below zero. So does that answer your question, or you have?
Yes, there it does understand.
Yeah. So basically, it encapsulates all these features. So that's why I was, so excited about the Heston model, because using only three extra parameters, Heston model incorporates so many important features of financial asset return. In addition, we can also allow for correlation between the stochastic components at the rate low. So that's the SDE. So far, very good news. The bad news comes when you try to derive the characteristic function of the log asset class. Bad news, not in the sense that you are not able to do it. So Heston is very good. For Heston, you can actually derive the analytical form of the characteristic function. The bad news is that it takes a lot of tedious manipulations, lot of tedious algebra to arrive at that point. So I'll just mention the starting and the finishing point here. So the characteristic function for the log asset price under Heston volatility model is given by this symbol phi again. So it's expectation of IU log ST, of course. That's the generic term. If you collect all the relevant features from these two equations, one can show that this will be given by this function. So you can understand why I said bad news. Because even though I'm able to write an analytical expression, it's not a simple one. Because I have two equation system, and I also have a volatility of the volatility. So in some sense, I am actually working with the kurtosis also. So the characteristic function becomes quite complicated. So this is the full form of the expectation expression, which after a lot of manipulations and simplifications, you can show that this expectation reduces to this term here. So it takes quite a bit of manipulation. I will not get into that. If you want to understand how it is done, Hirsa has all the details. In fact, this is the only case where Hirsa derives all the detail calculations, just to show how these things are done. And for other cases, it says that similarly, or using analogous techniques, etc., etc. So I can go back to the book and show you. That would be only fair. So page 13 is where it starts. So this was the Heston model characteristic function definition here that I have shown. I have pasted in my notes. And then it gives one detailed derivation of this process, which goes across these pages. from page 13 to page 18 to be precise. And then putting everything together, this is the final expression that I again pasted in my notes. So if you want to understand how these manipulations are done, it is there in the book, but I will not want to spend time on that because it is, as I said, quite tedious. Any questions? You all also have the book with you because I have shared it in the classroom. So you all have access to the PDF here. Any questions? Okay, so no questions. So I can put this in the examination, right?
Nah, sir.
So unless you ask me questions, I will assume trivial questions, correct?
There is nothing really to ask you. This is an expression that is difficult to compute. And I mean difficult to derive. That's all it is.
It is difficult to derive. It is, yes. Yeah. No, but you see, this is like, you know, some of the central limit theorem proofs, that the proofs in itself may be tedious, but there are certain tricks there which you might find useful for your own work later on. So sometimes it is good to see, good to go through even tedious proofs, not necessarily for this purpose only, but maybe for some other purpose. So that's why I am, you know, showing you the source of the source material, because there would be useful tricks involved in this derivation. All right. So this is the characteristic function final form. So I do have an analytical expression, closed form, explicit expression, even though it might be tedious to derive, but that makes Heston more powerful because then I have an explicit SDE, I have an explicit characteristic function, which means I'm in a very strong position computationally. Even though I am able to incorporate volatility clustering, a very important feature of financial returns data, with a few parameters in a very smart way, so that I still have closed form expressions for all the relevant things that I need here. So if you want to do computational work, all the programs will be quick. I can just plug in these expressions, estimate the parameter values, done. I get all the relevant graphs and everything. Okay. So far, so good. So now let us go a little bit further. Let us talk about the next generalization of the stochastic volatility model, which is called a mixing model or a stochastic local volatility model. So what is a stochastic local volatility model? The trick is I now separate the stock price source and the stochastic source. So earlier in the Heston model, the generating equation had this square root of VT ST, this product. ST was the direct contribution of the stock price. And otherwise, it was the stochastic driving factor. Now what we do is, I may want to allow a more general functional form of the stock price to influence volatility, not directly ST, but maybe some function of ST. So that is what this local volatility component does here. So I have this L function. It's a deterministic function, by the way, of the stock price and time, which takes care of changes in volatility, deterministic changes in volatility due to the stock price. Apart from also having the stochastic part VT, which has a similar mean reverting generating equation. So I have a deterministic transform of the stock price and time influencing the volatility term here, apart from st only, st dwt is as before. I have this additional term, and then I have vt, which is again the mean reverting process, and it's a mean reverting log normal process, because now in the dw2 term I have put a constant only. I am no longer inserting the square root of vt term, so it becomes a direct normal distribution kind. So do you see? So there are two important things. One is that I am allowing a more general influence of the stock price through a deterministic function L. I may need that depending on some features of the data. And in the volatility of volatility generating equation, I have a constant rate. So I make a generalization here and I make a simplification here in the second equation. So that's how smart models are made. So you do not generalize too much. If you want to let go in one direction, you push back in some other direction to keep a balance in terms of computational power, estimation, you know, estimability, etc. So as in Heston again, kappa is the rate of mean reversion, theta is the long-term drift, which can be now dependent on time. Lambda is the volatility of volatility, which is now constant. Well, there are certain conditions that has to be here in order to make the definition consistent. As sigma square STT is interpreted as the average local variance. If you think of this as your average local variance, local means in terms of the, as a function of stock price and time. So that puts a constraint on the unconditional expectation of VT square. So if you look at this model, VT square has to be calibrated by this unconditional expectation of VT square to be equal to 1. Do you see that? So I want the unconditional expectation to be some constant. 1 is not necessary, but if I want a constant, then I can as well put 1. I have to make that unconditional expectation of VT square a constant, which would imply through some algebra that theta t, because this is the long-term variance, remember, the long-term variance must obey this equation. Theta t must be lambda squared by 2 kappa, 1 plus e to the power minus 2 kappa t. So I will just recall one exercise in Hoyle-Portstone in last term, Hoyle-Portstone chapter 6, where you did this calculation. Do any of you remember? It was one of the exercises. Of course, last semester was so long ago, but this is an exercise from Hoyle-Portstone. Maybe it's a good time to, you know, reopen Hoyle-Portstone and look it up, because this derivation was done as an exercise there. Okay, so again, I have this stochastic local volatility model. This local term comes through this L function, which is a deterministic function of stock price and time, which can allow more tailor-made influence of the stock price on the volatility, along with the usual mean reversion in the variance, stochastic component of the variance generating equation, which also puts some restrictions on the parameters of the model. So theta t function cannot be any arbitrary function. It has to be of this particular form. So if I consider this process, kappa theta t minus log vt, then theta t must be determined by this exponential function. There is an alternative to stochastic local volatility model, where instead of log vt as the underlying variable, one can directly function vt. So you can replace this generating equation of volatility, which is in log scale, by this arithmetic scale generating equation. So dVt itself is modeled as a mean reverting function of Vt. So the changes are very straightforward. So I don't work in the log scale, I work in the original scale. So dVt as a function of theta t minus Vt here, and I insert a Vt so that the logarithmic rule can still be applied in this volatility part. That is one possible variation. One can also assume correlation between the Brownian motions as in the Heston model. So you may assume a rate of correlation rho between dW1 and dW2. However, the original model assumes a zero correlation, just to make it simple, because more parameters you have and correlations you have, it's harder to calibrate. Note that if L has no dependence on stock price, so if L is actually independent of stock price, then we essentially revert back to the Heston model. So we don't have any additional influence of the stock price in the volatility part. So that means we are essentially going back to the Heston model. And if I let lambda to be zero, if I make this equation deterministic, so if lambda goes to zero, then this generating function of volatility Vt becomes deterministic. Then it degenerates to the usual local volatility model. So either you can take out the local influence part, LST, then it becomes a stochastic volatility, or you can take out the stochastic part from the generating, the volatility generating equation, then it becomes a local volatility. There are two terms here, stochastic and local. So I can specialize this model to either only a stochastic volatility model, L goes away, or a local volatility model where lambda goes away. So in that sense, this mixing model is a mix of both the features, and the original models are special cases of this mixing model. Is that clear? Because I started my discussion with a local volatility model, which was not very nice, Dunman and Kani. Then we discussed the stochastic volatility model, Heston, which is very nice, very popular. And then we talked about a mixing model, which incorporates both features in a smart way. And of course, then the earlier two models are special cases of this mixing. So this mixing model is often used in empirical work, although it is quite, it's not simple, it's complicated. But of course, once you understand how to calibrate the Heston's model, a mixing model can also be calibrated if you can handle the L function smartly. Because you see here, in statistical work, the important part will be guessing a possible form for the L function. Once you fix the L function, then the rest will be almost according as the Heston's model. The algorithm will be very similar. Do you see that? Because eventually that's what we are going to do. Eventually we are going to have data and we are going to calibrate models through whatever method possible. So here, all the other terms are quite nice, simply parameterized. Only this L function stands out as a very general formulation. So in statistical work, that would be the challenge to determine what is the simplest possible form of L function that suits your data. So is it okay? Shall we move ahead?
Yes, sir.
All right. So now let us go back to our old favorite. It is my favorite, really. The GBM with mean reversion, or Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process. We have discussed this earlier, so let me recap. So Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, why did it come into being? The basic reason was that constant drift assumption is incompatible with market prices. Because in general, in the markets, the long-term price movements usually tries to come back to a long-term mean. So if you look at price movements over a longer time scale, there you most of the time you will see tendencies that the prices or the returns try to come back to some stationary, some stable level. It may fluctuate a lot. It may not even remain stationary, but in the long run, it tries to come back to some mean, some central value. So in case of financial asset prices, a constant drift assumption is considered equally incompatible. But what is considered to be quite common, quite a common feature of financial prices or returns is that the long-term movements tries to come back. So this is called mean reversion. Common examples are interest rates, currency exchange rates, commodity prices. Typically, interest rates have some long-term historical point of attraction where it tries to come back. Exchange rates, due to macroeconomic factors, tries to remain stable or tries to go back to a stable value, at least in the long run. And commodity prices, which are typically subject to seasonal fluctuations on a multi-year basis, tries to go back to a stable level. These are common examples of mean reverting processes, but there are others. And for all these kinds of models or more to the point, for all these kinds of markets, Ornstein-Uhlenbeck model is a very popular model. So it is an instance of a Gaussian process that has a bounded variance. We have seen that it admits a stationary probability distribution in contrast to the Wiener process. The difference between the two is in their drift term. So for the Wiener process, drift term is constant. So it keeps moving in a one direction. But for Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, it cannot keep moving in one direction. If the current value is less than the long-term mean, the drift will become positive, it will start coming back up. If the current value is above the long-term mean, the drift will be negative and it will try to come down. So this mean will act as the equilibrating or the equilibrium level for the process. So that's how Ornstein-Uhlenbeck is understood. And of course, the SDE for Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process, let us say the symbol, the variable is now called RT. So RT is generated by this equation. DRT is kappa eta minus RT dt lambda DWT. Eta is the long-term mean, kappa is the speed of average, speed of adjustment, lambda is the volatility of volatility. Or here it is only volatility. WT is of course the Wiener process. So the simplest Ornstein-Uhlenbeck model, mean reversion process, is generated by this equation. This we know more or less quite well. So let us now think of application of this. And of course, for us, application is in one of the financial markets. And the first example that we are going to talk about is for the interest rate market. So the oldest and most direct application of the OU process is driven by this model called the Vasicek model. So again, named after the person who developed it. So Vasicek's model is used for instantaneous spot interest rate, which is also called the short rate. Short means as in short-term interest rate. So we assume that the spot interest rate follows an OU process. The advantage is that we know that the short rate usually vacillates around the long-term mean. Historical data tells us that the short rate usually fluctuates around the long-term mean. So a Brownian motion model would not be appropriate for this. And because it fluctuates around the long-term mean, that causes the long-term variance to be bounded also. Because remember, that for a geometric Brownian motion, the long-term variance, which is proportional to time, will become unbounded when time becomes larger and larger. But in a mean reverting process, the long-term variance remains bounded. So we have already seen one example of that here. So the Vasicek model for the short rate, it picks up the empirical features like mean reversion as well as the long-term variance to be bounded, which are supported by data, and incorporates them here. So it's the market rates usually grow slowly. So the feature that people have seen for a long time is that market rates rarely grow exponentially. They will usually grow very slowly, so they do not really will go to very large levels. So typically, as soon as it starts growing, then something brings them back down. The disadvantage of using the Vasicek model as it is defined here is the fact that I can actually get negative interest rates, because remember that the Heston model adjusted for that by using a square root of RT. Here it would have been a square root of RT term here with the DWT to prevent it from going below zero. But in the original Vasicek model, that adjustment is not made. So the Vasicek model can indeed demonstrate short rates which are negative. That's a very uncommon situation in the market, of course. But well, each model has its advantages and disadvantages. The Vasicek model, this was the oldest model, so it had to be very simple. Why? Because the natural reason, computing power was very limited when these models were developed. So he proposed the simplest possible model, even though there was a disadvantage to this, that the short rate can become negative. There is nothing to prevent it from going below zero. But okay, let us start with the Vasicek model for the short-term interest rate, which is this model here. So to derive the generating equations here, what is done is the following. So we apply the Itô's lemma, not directly to RT, but to RT into e to the power kappa t. See, this is like the integrating factor choice. If you looked at this as a differential equation, first order differential equation, so this lambda part you remove for the time being, ignore for the time being, then the integrating factor choice would be e to the power kappa t. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is a standard differential equation. Again, we have done this last term. So that's what is being done here. So we apply Itô's lemma to RT into e to the power kappa t. Then we can do the integrating factor and we can solve the SDE. Then you know the details, you can do it. So you solve the SDE to get this closed form expression for RT. So RT will be driven by this mean part. So this is the mean part with the long-term adjustment. So it cannot move in one direction indefinitely. So it is R naught e to the power minus kappa t, which is actually taking it to zero, given that kappa is positive. But this part is the mean reversion part, where in the long run, it will be close to eta. It will move to eta. So the departure from eta will be again determined by this exponential term. So this is the trend part. The trend part is essentially something that approaches eta in the long run. And this is the volatility part, sigma e to the power minus kappa t, integral of lambda e to the power k s dw. Again, this was an exercise in Hoyle-Portstone. If you can open the book again and check, you will find it there. Maybe you don't remember right now, but this was also an exercise. So we have two Hoyle-Portstone exercises, remember this one and this one. They are very similar actually. Both are on mean reversion, mean reverting equations and standard examples. So this is my generating function, analytical expression for RT. Not very difficult to develop. But there is a little bit more. So while in most of the previous cases, previous means the stochastic volatility or stochastic local volatility, the characteristic function of the log of the stock price was what we wanted to derive. So log ST was typically our target. So phi of log ST. Here it would have been RT, the return rate. When modeling instantaneous interest rates, actually, we are not intrinsically interested in RT only, because RT is only valid for a short instant of time, because RT is definitely changing. Instead, what people are usually interested in is the realized interest rate up to time t. So RT is the instantaneous interest rate, valid for only the instant small t. But what people are interested in seeing is what is the realized rate over an interval 0 to t. And that is given by capital RT, which is nothing but the integral of RU dU. So if R were a constant, then you know what would happen. Then it would just be multiplied by t. And you know that if R is the interest rate for 1 unit of time, then over t units of time to be RT. But now that we have allowed R to be a function of time with a particular shape, with this particular mean reverting shape, and you know that this is the generating function of RT, what we are actually interested in is the realized interest rate, which is an integral of this process again. Is the issue clear? Why we are interested not in small r but in the realized interest rate capital R?
Yes, sir.
So can you explain to me why?
This R capital RT is the return of, like, if I want to determine the return at time t, then that R capital RT is the return, and small rt is the instantaneous rate. So that is only valid for just instant of time t.
So actually there is a physical reason also. Typically what happens is the interest rate markets are not a short term market. So when we are talking about stock prices, we often have very high frequency trading. People buy and sell things in quick time. So things happen very quickly. So you are only interested in a very small interval of time, how the stock price evolves. But the interest rate markets are typically of a longer duration. People take short-term loans, but this short-term is not like short-term as in the stock price, like milliseconds. Here, short-terms are actually weeks or months. So we are not really interested in just understanding what is the instantaneous rate. We really want to understand what is the realization over the next 3 months or at least 1 month. So interest rate short term is not like our stock price short term. The interest rate time scale is bigger. When I say long term, I mean maybe 5 years or 3 years. And when I say short term, I will understand 1 month or 3 months. If we were talking about the stock price or the stock market, then short term could be fraction of second because of high frequency trading or algorithmic trading. So I think the short term needs to be understood correctly in this context. And that is why, as Subrajyoti explained, we are interested in the realized interest because our time interval 0 to t is not really short in our sense, not short. It's like month. Again, as you can see that if I want to understand the integral of RT, I have to do an integration over this equation 1.27. So I will be involved in a double integral. I already have an integral here. So again, there will be some tedious manipulations so that I can avoid double integration, etc. As I mentioned before, one can show, luckily one can show that, not luckily, again, we know this result. One can show that capital RT also follows the normal distribution. We know this result because of our theoretical studies in the last semester, correct? What is the result am I using? Can anyone recall? Anyone? So this is the equation for RT. And I say that one can show that the integrated version of this again follows a normal distribution. Let's not worry about the parameters yet, because that is just algebra. But the fact that RT is again normal distribution follows directly from some result we studied last time. So there are no responses. That's unfortunate. So, okay. So I will ask you this question again next week. This is actually very straightforward answer, but anyway. So I claim that this integrated interest rate, which is called realized interest rate, so maybe I should make it bold, this is again a normally distributed random variable with mean given by this mean adjustment parameter, mean reversion parameter, and sigma square, which looks like a Cartesian term. So there will be some, obviously some algebra involved here, but the main part was that it is still following the normal distribution. And of course, once we make that claim, once we justify our claim of normal distribution, then the characteristic function would be easy to derive, because I have already evaluated the mu and sigma square. So the characteristic function of a normal random variable is always given by this equation 129. We have done that. So all we do is we substitute mu sigma. We get the characteristic function for capital R as e to the power ATU minus BTU R0. So we write it in this fashion. It would be easier to interpret, where ATU is given by this expression and BTU is given by this expression. They are coming from this here after some simplifications. So BTU is defined as this, and then ATU is defined using BTU. You recall, note that BTU also appears in the definition of B, in the definition of A. Because otherwise it will look too complicated. There's no point writing it again. So that's how the characteristic function for the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck model due to Vasicek can be derived. So the model that we have used is a simple mean reverting model with constant volatility rate. We have shown that use of Itô's lemma helps us to solve the SDE for RT. So I can have an explicit form for small rt, the instantaneous interest rate. The realized interest rate, capital R, which is an integral from 0 to t of small r, can also be shown to follow a normal distribution, luckily for us, with mu and sigma square given by these two equations. And then obviously the characteristic function for our realized interest rate, capital R, can be directly written out, because we know the characteristic function of the normal random variable, which finally gives us this expression here. The expectation of IURT, e to the power IURT is given by e to the power a minus b r 0. A and b are defined as in here. So this will be just simple algebra. So but the final form is as in the normal distribution. That's the big advantage. And if you are interested in computing the term structure, so you remember the term structure was required for the bond pricing bonds. Last term we spent a little bit of time in term structure when we were talking about bonds and bond prices. The notation is typically capital P starting from small t and finishing at capital T. So capital P is the price. So for the Vasicek model, for this model here, if I derive the term structure, then again we can explicitly get the term structure as, of course, expectation of e to the power minus capital R T, because that will be the discounting, time discounting rate. If you remember the bond price calculations last term, it was essentially a time discounting rate. It is like if I get rupee 1 at time capital T, then standing at time small t, what is the value of that 1 rupee? And that is typically given by a time discounting formula. Here, the discounting will be done by a stochastic interest rate, RT, small rt. So for this time interval, what we need to do is discount by the realized interest rate. So that is the trick for finding the term structure in the Vasicek model. And how do I evaluate expectation of e to the power minus RT? Again, our old trick of taking u equal to minus I. So if I put u equal to minus I in this formula here, I will get the exact expression for the term structure of interest rate. So again, this is a little bit of thing that I am carrying over from last term. So you should do, the revision thing again. Some of the revision things are absolutely necessary to look up what is a term structure and how did we calculate the time discounting rates. And once I put that u equal to minus I, then you know exactly what will happen here. I will get some expression which gets simplified, and capital PTT is easily computable and calibrated. Calibration would be very straightforward. All right, so this is where I want to stop today, because there is the next model would be something different, so I don't want to discuss it right now. So are there any questions at this point? So I had asked you to start reading the book, which you of course haven't done, I understand, but the sooner you start the better, because if you now look at the book, you will see that I am skipping a lot of material, which is part of the syllabus, many details, but you have to read up those details. And more importantly, the concepts, definitions, and some of the exercises that I am using from last term, you need to look them up, recall them, mostly from Hoyle-Postone for now, but also from Pliska and Oxendahl as we go along. Because this is like the second part of that course. These courses are not independent, so you need to look up, recall, recap certain things from time to time.